Marie Chauvet, Seder of Revolt, and I think we had already, quite an afternoon with presentations and discussions between the panels, also with the audiences. Many of you were here. Maybe you raised your arm. Who was here in the afternoon? Yeah, oh, that's wonderful. So thank you for staying. We all know how much it means to take out time, especially in a city like New York. And we do need good theater, we need good writers, but we also really do need a good audience that engages and things that what we do is of significance and meaningful. My name is Frank Henschke, I'm the director of programs together with Antje Ögo and the executive director of the Segal Center. We bridge academia and professional theater, international and American theater. And for many, many years we have done Haitian events here, four or five, and slot with Thomas Speer, who's also with us here, and Francesca Saltman from the European Institute, who has really supported this whole day. Without her, this wouldn't have happened on that scale, so we would like to thank her. She was here as the opening speaker today, couldn't be with us in the evening, so we really would like to thank her, and it is really a meaningful collaboration here at the Graduate Center, but also with Lehman College. I also would like to thank for the additional support from Ira Dag, who helped us to get Gina over here for the readings in the afternoon. Really, a lot of thank yous to Alessandra and Kaima, both of them, who made this happen and came to me with the idea, so I think they really deserve a round of applause. The playwright who lives now in France and wanted to also be part of it, also emailed me about the project and he couldn't ultimately come here, but I think it's a really significant event and it also shows the vitality and the creativity that comes from a country like Haiti, and we all don't know enough about it. Some people do, and they were the speakers this afternoon and this evening, so I really thank you for coming. We will have three readings, it's all in the program, and they are all directed by Alice Rieken. Alice, where are you?
Yes,
over there.
So thank you
for doing that. And the readings will be followed by a discussion, the panelists on your program. And Thomas was kind enough to give some opening remarks also for some of you who haven't been here in the afternoon. Thank you again for all the speakers who contributed so richly. This event is live streamed, it's online. You can also get to our archives and look at it. And please let everybody know about this and contact us in case you have any questions or follow-up things or you want to create something around. And we also welcome of course, students, but others with us here. So thank you for coming, and so many others. If you have a cell phone, now is the time to take it out, and I'll do the same. I'll make sure the sound is off. So it doesn't ring. Actually, never rings at our events, and it's really, really, really true. There will be a little reception in this space afterwards with a glass of wine in case you have additional questions. And then we go over to the archive bar in case you want to join us. The reception will be here. I again would like to thank Gina. Is she still with us? Gina, the actress who read the text the afternoon, but she did a great job, and she will be back, so thank you for it. It does make a difference. That's what we also do here. We have a performance element. We want to hear the words of the artist spoken and read, and they should be part of it, and also creates a community. So now again, thank you for coming, and Thomas, I'm going to hand it over, and congratulations, you got an award in for your work on Haitian literature. And maybe say a little word about it.
Yes, it was. I'm officially a Galtian to lead the first non-Haitian to be such awarded a Carolyn Shred was in May. I guess there's something to follow up on in the thanks. Frank Henschke mentioned a number of the people responsible today, and I think it's important for me to acknowledge his work with the Segal Theater. They've been very supportive of our work and bringing a lot of really wonderful new playwrights from around the world, including from French language, and that doesn't mean necessarily from Europe, but all over, introducing works to a New York audience. And also, of course, from the PhD program here at the Graduate Center, the Henri Père French Institute, and the IRADAR that helped sponsor this. And again, thank you so much, Alessandra and Kayama, and McLaren Alessandra. Benedicte Koken, who put this together. They are also the editors of the special issue of Yale French Studies that came out earlier this year on Marie Chauvet. I just wanted to make a couple comments about this, the centennial year. We did something in March to begin the year. This is the centennial of Marie Chauvet's birth. And her sister, who lives uptown in Harlem, heard about it and really wanted to come and was really hoping to come tonight. But Lillian is 102 years old, and she's tired. But the family is here in spirit, and there's interesting stories in that there were celebrations, for example, here. In Haiti, there was a major event in May because it was their annual book festival, Livre Folie, and Marie Chauvet was the writer of honor this year, and there were a lot of events there, including a day-long session at the Bibliothèque Nationale. And for me, what's most important is her works were censored for so many years, were prevented from being republished, and this year, the centennial of her birth, all of her works are available in Haiti for the first time. They were reissued for the Livre Folie Festival. It's wonderful for people here in the room tonight to be able to hear some of her work translated into English, but what is really exciting for us, those of us who've been working on her work for some 30 years, it's only been since the clandestine edition of the trilogy was published in 2003 that things kind of broke open with the family and they've allowed the works to be published. But it's really exciting to see what's being done in Haiti with young readers. And I think tonight you will see, I mean, Marie Chauvet is much more known as a novelist, and we had a very interesting panel on one of her, dealing especially with one of her plays. I think that's a minor piece, and others can argue otherwise, but from some of the things you will see or hear now, one is José Pliat's version of Amour, and Amour was staged many times. He has done it with Magali Comot with Denis playing. Michel Voltaire-Marcellin has also played the role. I've always said that I think the first part of the trilogy, Love, would make a great telenovela, stage in period piece. But from what we heard earlier, readings of Dans le Volcan, I think there's many, many possibilities in the work of Marie Chauvet to develop into theatrical interpretations, visual interpretations, and I think we'll see many more. There's a Haitian artist who lives in Berlin, Jean-Éric Désert, who did a stage piece in Martinique called Amour, Colère et Folie, using iconography of François Nau, Aimé Césaire, and Christian Taubira, and others who revolted in many ways, as Marie Chauvet did. I can go on, and I don't need to. There's an interesting story this year for, I was interested in, this year, this family put a flower on her grave. I figured if she died in New York, she must have been buried here. Well, through the family, I found out that they had cremated her and, not cremated, excuse me, embalmed her and sent her body to be buried during the dictatorship. This is 76, I believe, in the cemetery of Port-au-Prince. And I wanted to go there and no one could find the tomb. And it's a family caveau. And Robert Saint-Alphonse, through my inspiration, went and found out where it was. It was completely covered with plants and overgrown. And for the centennial, they cleaned it all up. And what I wanted to bring with you is I just on this a volume that was published in Haiti for the event of La Livre en Folie on Amour avec Marie, and a number of writers, especially Haitian writers, wrote a lot of things about what she means to them today. And I think we really are in what they say in French, in année charnière, where it's only been about 10 years that people have been reading Chauvet because her books have been reissued. And I think something's changing this year with the Yale French studies, with this text, with the publications of the translations. I think as we saw the dynamism this afternoon, she's become the world renowned writer that she. Interesting to see there's going to be a before and an after, and now she belongs to everyone. But for many, many years, people weren't reading her. So we're going to hear, I think we can have the introduction of the readers. Alice can present the readers that she has scheduled to read. Among the things you're going to hear is an excerpt of La Légion des Fleurs, translated by Alessandra Benedetti Coquelin. You're going to hear from Pellas, the theatrical adaptation of Amour, and also an excerpt of Les Rapaces, that's translated by Carolyn Schreiber, who's here today. So I hope you all enjoy.
Of my cherished commitment to this public in university. Yu Chen for working so efficiently alongside us, I know she is, as well as Anish and Rebecca at the Segal. Judy Miller, one of the few two or three persons whom I can really call a mentor, for accepting to be part of this event. Gina Ulysse for being incredible this afternoon, and I can't wait to hear you speak later. Christian Flau for sensitizing me over the years to the importance of theater and performance as literary genres, and Thomas for all of your relentless work to make sure that the world knows about so many authors everywhere. Christian will be editing a volume about that will be coming out of this event, so if you're interested, come see me or Christian. I also would like to make a formal gesture to my students who are here tonight from our course titled Crime Narratives of the Americas as part of the Study of the Americas program at City College. I'll save my longer comments for the final readings we will hear tonight, and so I will only briefly introduce the Legend of the Flowers. The play is one of Chauvet's earliest publications. She wrote it, published it in 46-47, and Thomas can correct me if I'm wrong, under the pseudonym of Coripri. It takes place in a sumptuous garden in which all of the protagonists are of the non-human natural realm. There are various flowers, the sun, and a butterfly. The story seems harmless. A sunflower, a pink rose, and a violet discuss their love interests, and notably their attraction to the sun and the butterfly. The sun is the steady, reliable lover, one who comes every day at the same time, but also must leave to attend to other flowers, i.e. lovers. For his part, the butterfly is a frivolous womanizer, so present and at other times completely absent. And as Régine Michel Jean-Charles and Christian Flaw explained earlier today, despite the lightness of the dialogue and the beauty of the scenery, Legend of the Flowers is much more upsetting, but also a philosophical treatise on human nature, as Régine Joseph pointed out to us. So, to Alice, I think.
The actors know what to do.
Okay.
I don't think we need that. The Legend of the Flowers, a one-act magical extravaganza by Marie Chauvet, translated from the French by Alessandro Benedicti Cochin. The scene is that of a large, somewhat somber garden. On the grass, three flowers are asleep, a pink rose, a violet, and a flower. Scene one. The rose awakes, stretching herself out so as to coquettishly flutter the rumpled petals that surround her.
Oh, already the sun rises, and the daybreak coquettishly has adorned herself in varied colors. The dewdrops tremble on her hair, and her shawl resembles the azure of the sky. She's like a lady in waiting who looks forward to her lover's awakening. She makes herself beautiful in the first light of day. She has hands that search and a gaze that spies. Poor Aurora, always looking for new lovers. Today it's the white cloud that passes, tomorrow the other cloud, so gray it looks like an old man. She has loved everywhere. She is flirtatious with all of them. She thinks that she's irresistible because she lives in the skies, and even when the sun goes down, she tries in vain to continue her reign, screaming loudly, "Tomorrow I will be back!"
Rose! Rose, what is it?
Nothing. I was speaking about Aurora.
She's still here. How naughty of her! Why is my golden star waiting so long to chase her away?
Maybe she's waiting for you to wake up.
Oh, there's nothing, like, there's nothing that he likes to do more than to wake me up by myself. I feel one of his rays now softly caressing my eyes, forcing them open. I am bedazzled to find him here, so close to me.
It must be difficult to have such a seductive lover, to keep him loyal to you?
And a lover that is so well liked.
Yes, indeed. He is loved by so many, I know. Is it possible to keep such a beautiful star from attracting all of the flowers?
Especially when this star is looking for so much love.
Is it even possible to keep such a dazzling sun from breaking so many hearts without meaning to? For he is everywhere. He is the most celebrated, the most adored. He has caressed me so faithfully that when his golden rays and my petals had become one and the same, I remember meeting him when I was just a miserable small flower, pale and fearful. He was always there for me, charming me and attentive to my needs. He kept me warm and helped me to wipe away the dewdrops that were stuck to my petals. I let him do it. I didn't dare say anything. Is it possible to complain about being loved so intensely? And then every morning I start to wait for him, begging Aurora to leave, asking her to hasten her departure, then he would come with his golden rays, joyful and charming. He would press his light on my trembling stem. Like the hand of love, he would remain there for a long time. A very long time. Then, one day, I saw myself brilliantly yellow, just like him, so absolutely similar that I suddenly felt lost, beguiled, forever lost to him.
Tell me, sunflower,
is it good to be loved so intensely,
to become as you are, possessed by a unique thought? Have you not suffered?
Yes! Have you not suffered from love loving this globe of fire who shines his rays upon everyone, this fickle lover who bestows his fancies upon everyone? Even if there are some flowers that he leaves in the shadows, there are thousands of others that, like you, wait for him to awake them. And so many others that, like you, hope each day to be caressed and touched.
You consider yourself one of those that he's left behind?
Well, that being said, you really are beautiful. I'm scared of him. I run from his rays. I hide myself. And even in the comfort of the humidity of my retreat, I tremble from the cold, just so he will leave me alone.
I am always worried.
Undoubtedly, we have said too much.
It's nothing. Do not pay attention to me.
Oh, do not cry, my beautiful one. It does not matter if he smiles upon others, if it's always you that he returns to. It does not matter if his thoughts digress elsewhere, for when he's sad, it is your presence that he requests. And when at night he retires, tired and frigid from the cold, are you not the only one who guards his glow within her very being? Are you not the only one to preserve the golden aura of his rays within the shine of her petals?
Enough. You could not possibly understand. And so because you love the sun, no other flower after you is capable of understanding your suffering. When I am close to him, everything else seems pallid. It all makes me very selfish, I guess.
And if I were to tell you that there are other lovers, lovers who mesmerize the roses, and if I were to tell you that these lovers are the most unfaithful, the most fickle, and the most thoughtless. Unlike your son, they do not take care of us. They abandon us. They break our hearts, always frivolous, and each day they resemble someone else.
Oh! The butterfly!
Beautiful white butterfly enters. Lightly and charmingly, he kisses the rose and the sunflower. The violet, seeing him, comes towards her, quickly hides herself, burying her face in her arms.
Good morning. Good morning. Still so shy. Sweet violet, it really is a shame. And you, Rose, you are more alert than ever.
Please, a minimum of decorum.
Now, now, are you angry?
Certainly, there's reason to be upset.
My God, what are you going to accuse me of now? What am I guilty of? But if indeed I have offended you, dear and beautiful pink rose, please accept my apologies.
Forgive you, that's all I ever do.
Have you already tired of me?
I'm not certain. Sometimes I just want to break everything off. I always see you conniving, always taunting me, always lighthearted, going from dragonfly to the humming bee, flying from one flower to another, priggish, so full of yourself, egotistical and charming. And in those moments, I cannot stand having you around. In other moments, I see you so weak, so childish and charming too, that I fear for you, as one worries over a burning candle when the storm's dangerous breath comes roaring in. In those moments, I want to protect you. To protect you from yourself, I want to scream, take care that they do not clip your wings. Take care that you do not lose the wind that alights beneath your wings.
Her, Rose, you give me the shivers. What morbid humor, my darling. One might think that I am a drab and a sad butterfly, incapable of holding my own.
You know that you are a handsome butterfly, but if you still want compliments...
Rose, please do not be upset.
But I'm not angry.
Fine. That's good. Ah, what a pain. I must get out of here.
Already?
I have some business to take care of. Work. Lots and lots of work. Ah, what I would give to stay a bit longer, but alas, I must go, Rose. Sunflower. Nothing is as beautiful as you. Timid violet, show me your face.
Leave me alone, let me be.
Just leave her alone, would you?
silly little one, you are missing out on all that is the most delicious in this world. You hide. You are always in the background. You remain in the shadows, ignoring the nuances that speckle the day. I have absolutely no admiration for you. You're nothing but a little coward.
And maybe among us all, she is the happiest.
The happiest? But how can she know happiness if she has never even lived? She does not know anything about life. She's terrified of everything. Of love, of what others think of her, of herself. Ah, happiness is anything but remaining closed in on oneself. The mistakes that we make, and those that we learn not to make again. This is what perfection is made of. We seek out new conquests. We must aspire to ascend higher, always higher. To love is to fight, to surmount the opinions others have of us. To live is to be able to look ourselves honestly in the face and say to ourselves, it is good. Even if deep down we must be harsh with ourselves, even if our action, in our actions, is born the suffering of others.
Go! Leave! Do you hear me? Get out of here!
Till tomorrow, Rose.
Maybe he's more sincere than the others. Why'd you chase him away, Violet?
Oh, I don't know. Everything he says terrifies me.
Oh, the sun is coming. I can feel his heat, which penetrates me, which fills me with warmth.
The sun enters at the same time that the room lights up. He's wearing an outfit of brilliantly shining gold with a sparkling diadem on his head. In each hand, he holds a golden wand, which he extends when he wants to project his rays.
Oh, God, how beautiful he is!
Why did you not wait for me to waken you?
You made me wait so long.
My path was hard. Flirtatious Aurora would not stop smiling. And this cloud that you see here, so full of arrogance and dust, kept me from passing. No, you will not pass, the cloud told me. Today is not your day. I must make rain. And for her part, Aurora begged me, let me stay just a little longer. I am waiting for someone. And so I found myself having to force them to disappear.
So you got into a fight?
A bit. You tell me if I'm exhausted or do I just look it?
Oh, no. You are stunning.
The sun, extending his arms, projects a quick ray of light towards the violet, who trembles a bit and moves to bury herself further into her arms. He bends over to get close to her.
What is this? Oh, the violet.
Do you not see how she trembles? Leave her in peace.
Maybe you are jealous.
Of you? That would be a true waste of time.
In any case, she is in love with a butterfly.
With a butterfly?
Do you really think you're the only one who's attractive around here?
I need help. I already have much, much to do.
The violet gets up. She advances, starstruck, her hands clasped.
What are you doing, Violet?
It is so strange. For once, I want to try, just for a moment, to emerge from my inertia. I have lived so long collapsed unto myself that any gesture at this point is a veritable revolution. But the fact is, I too am a flower. They say that I am beautiful, and so I too want to be in love.
But my poor thing, you're far too terrified of living.
I will give everything in the world to help you overcome your timidity.
Oh, no! No, 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 no! Just from having gazed upon you for such a long moment, my eyes are already burning.
But the butterfly said that she was nothing more than a cow.
The butterfly is a conceited idiot.
Excuse me.
Please do not fight because of me. It is true. I am a coward. Look at how my hands tremble and how nervous I am.
Go back to your corner, Violet, or you really will get sick.
From outside, we hear a song and laughter.
The flowers are taking a walk.
Here they are.
They are looking for you. They are running after you. Hide yourself. Hide! Hide!
Hide? But why? On the the contrary, that they enter, that they come to me if they need my warmth, that they come closer, for they love to feel my sun rays play on their petals. I belong to anyone who finds comfort and healing in my light. I am the fire that animates, that warms. My destiny is huge because I am the god of light and passion. I am the one who ignites the body, penetrates the heart, and destroys the shadow.
But because I love you, I...
Love me, kind flower. The flower that was created to look like me. Love me, if in the love that inspires you, you find the poetry and suffering that nurtures great beings. But since you really do love me, do you really want to keep me from helping others? Do you actually think you are the only one to live from my warmth?
I do not know. I love you.
But I also love you. I love your petals, whose petals look like my light. I love your loving sweetness and this trembling stem that holds you up. I love to imagine that in the morning you are waiting for me after behaving yourself and sleeping tranquilly in your own bed.
You sure are full of yourself.
There's more. Thank you. So our actors are now going to read an excerpt from Josie Pia's stage adaptation of Marie Chauvet's Love, which was generously translated for us by Lena Talbot. So Love is the first part of Chauvet's incendiary 1968 trilogy, Love, Anger, Madness. And it tells the story of Claire Clamont, a 39-year-old self-described old woman who belongs contentiously to the so-called mulatto elite class in Haiti. The story is set in 1939, but it's unmistakably meant to resonate with Haitian realities in the 1960s and beyond. Love exposes and incisively condemns the class, gender, and color politics, the modalities of hate, in other words, that too often have made solidarity impossible in Haiti. Bitter, self-loathing, and blessed, or cursed, with a keen social intelligence, Chauvet's Claire is our window onto the privilege and the pathologies that mark social relations in Haiti and, in many ways, the wider world. Thank you.
Love, a theatrical adaptation of Marie Vaux Chauvet, Amour, by José Plia, translated from the French by Lena Robles.
Leaving the office, Father Paul asks me to attend the Feast of the Virgin next Sunday. I would be one among the 12 daughters of Mary, which I have been a part of for 25 years. I would escort the Immaculate carrying a banner dressed in white with a blue belt. Despite the ruins, despite the misery, our town is still beautiful. The mountains and the sea that surround its horizons are full of beauty. The dried coffee branches acquire soothing pastel colors from far away, and the shore seems embroidered with foamy lace. A kelp odor emerges from the depth of the water. Light boats are tied to stakes stuck in the ground. Their sails draw white stains on the sea, and the sky, diving upon them, mixes its colors. The main road, rocky, more or less ruined from the cyclones, is full of greenish ditches where mosquitoes thrive. Trembling with fever, beggars are gathered at the edge of the ditches, collecting in the hollow of their hands smelly water for drinking. In the alleys, dilapidated shacks that are more or less holding on very shaky foundations give shelters to families with hollow cheeks and suspicious looks on their faces. Some poets, persecuted by the police, live there. That is also where Bob Shaveri, the Syrian, for whom Annette works. He has his trading house. Annette, the youngest one. 22 years old. Fresh, full of light. She is my sister. She is white, golden, under her skin, Her hair is black, a blue-black like her eyes. Except for her skin color, she is a touched-up copy of me 16 years ago. She wanders around the house making exclamations of cheerfulness and happiness. With her, the house is lively. A word for me.
It is appalling that Claire neglects herself so.
A word for Felicia.
Oh, poor thing. You don't look well.
And there she goes, her smile making dimples in her golden cheeks. Oh, I have thousands of anecdotes since that day when I was 16 and my dying mother gave her to me, saying,
raise her like your father raised you, and keep your sisters beneath your wing to protect them from sin.
One day, I decided to water a beautiful plant that she had brought from Bob's store. Day after day, I was marveled to see it come to life with the freshness of water. One evening, I water the plant. Annette arrives, bursts into laughter. The plant was artificial. Oh. Annette collects suitors. I do. She is young, she is beautiful, she is free. I do as mother told me. I watch her. The other evening, I saw her in the arms of her Syrian boss. She was in the back seat of the car. They had parked halfway in the garage. I saw everything, heard everything. I watched to make sure that no one bothered them. Mother can be reassured. I raised her well. Today was Sunday, the Feast of the Virgin. The church bells have rung tirelessly since the morning. I found myself dressed as a daughter of Mary. I resembled a nun in the dress made for me. It was I who requested the long sleeves and the high collar. In the procession, however, I looked well in comparison to the others. It was a horrendous cohort of old maids. I am nonetheless the best one among them. Children's heads, crowned in white, moved in front of me. Looking down, they threw handfuls of flowers from their baskets. All the balconies were decorated in the garlands of artificial flowers made by the nuns, hung sweetly between the trees in the street. The Virgin, radiant, sitting on a pedestal, was carried by four young men. We sung a choral arrangement composed by Father Paul.
May God shower us with the goodly rain of his sweet blessing, and may his holy name be blessed.
The prefect and the mayor, dressed in their gray wool suits, sweat blood and water. As they watch the procession go by and they cross themselves during the passage of the Holy Sacrament, Caladew and Mr. Long were at the door of the cirque. The priest blessed them. Running in comes Jock the Madman.
The gates of hell are open to swallow us.
Jock
the Madman. God curses us. Ooh. He opened the gates of hell upon us.
The singing stopped.
Caladew frowned. He put a whistle to his mouth.
Jock the Madman screamed still, pointing at him.
Father, beware of the devil!
Caladew lunged himself over at him, taking him by the collar.
His face disfigured from all the hatred, he slaps him.
Shut up, Satan!
Caladew pulled a revolver from his belt and at close range shot the lunatic, who fell to his knees without a complaint.
The procession stopped. Silence. Children cried, religious women held their rosaries. We remained standing, our bodies tense in a hypnotic stiffness, and covered in blood, Jacques began to crawl towards us, scraping the ground with his nails. Holding his head up, he moved slowly, painfully. Dr. Audier walked towards him. A bullet whistling at his feet nailed him to the ground, terrified.
Do not move.
Caladew walked backwards, his smoking gun in hand. We stayed transfixed in place. Father Paul whispered something to the choir children, and in an instant he was crowned with incense, elevating the monstrous above his head. He walked, surrounded by children, up to Caladew.
And now, I ask you to allow me to perform my priestly duties.
Caladew disappeared to the street corner. The humming of the prayers became more intense. Felicia is of average height, and rather voluptuous. She has light-skinned and dull blonde hair. She has the delicate features of a white woman. I dislike her. Too white, too blonde, too warm and measured. Since her marriage, no one exists aside from John Lewes. Handsome John Lewes, intelligent John Lewes. John Lewes, the mysterious and exotic foreigner who sets up his library and record collection in our house and makes fun of our way of living and our backwards thinking. He is the man without faults, the ideal husband. And Felicia's love and admiration overflows. She is blissful and carries her fetus so proudly in her womb. She trusts herself too much. She trusts everyone. Her serenity exasperates me. She spends her time smiling while she sews shirts for her future son, because it must also be a son. I bet Annette will be the godmother. This morning, I gave her broth. Her belly is larger than her tunic. In fact, a sperm whale. She will not leave the house in the arms of her husband. She is cool-headed and thinks of everything. Her health is fragile, and she is a bad housewife. To leave the house would be to lose at the same time her housekeeper, the old girl, the servant who does everything, who will wipe her son's bottom while she snuggles with her man. Crowded behind the partially open shutters, we observe the corpse lying in the streets. As we told the story to John Lewes and Felicia.
Are you sure that he is dead? Isn't there anything to do?
I will know later.
Later. Later. And you will stay here, trembling with fear.
Hush. Calm down.
It is none of my business. It's not my place to stand up to your district commandant. I'm in your home. It's not the passing foreigner's responsibility to reform a place where he does not belong.
Hush.
You have to protest. Respond to this with a demonstration. Face the danger together. They will not dare destroy an entire town. These murders, these tortures are meant to terrorize you. But if one of you leads an uprising of the town, then the fear will shift to the other side.
You don't understand anything.
John Lewes opened the door of the living room and with a gesture of anger went out. We saw him help carry the body. He awkwardly held the feet. John, I think I loved you from the very first moment. I remember your arrival in our country on a morning last year. It was a similar time of the year. A rental car covered in mud and dirt, driven by a black chauffeur, stopped coincidentally in front of our house. All the shutters were open, and at the same time, curious eyes stared at the newcomers behind the dusty yellow-laced curtains. Several days later, Dr. Audier introduced you to us.
John Lewes, the new employee at the Export Corporation, Mr. Lewes. These are the Clermont sisters.
Your amused gaze went around the room. It made Annette blush and stopped at Felicia.
Felicia, she lifted her eyes, looking at you both scared and with admiration, her mouth half open. She considered you.
As far as me. I think I loved you from the beginning. Remember? Before the blonde of my sisters dazzled you, I was there. The day of your arrival, I was sweeping the balcony. You opened the door and walked up to me. You barely said hello and asked me where to find the firm Export Corporation. I signaled to it with my hand. Do you remember? Do you remember? No! Like everybody else, you thought I was the servant. I am not the servant. And so that you can choose among the three of us, in all fairness, you should know who I am. I am the eldest of the Clermont sisters, the old girl, the one who didn't find a husband, who doesn't know what love is, who has not lived in the best sense of the term. I am 39 years old, and I am still a virgin. I am the different one. The one who doesn't resemble anyone. The one that came out wrong. Solitude has turned me bitter. I am like one of those fruits that fall before ripening and rot beneath the tree that no one deigns to touch. I repress a sea of love inside me. I wasted my charm in selfish solitude. My time for loving is obsolete. I am a desert that has no shelter to offer. It is too late for me to start living. That's what I used to think. What I used to tell myself before I saw you. Your large steps in the courtyard. The way you climbed the stairs, your voice, young and happy, lightly blurred, that it seemed to mute the happiness it gives. Your perfect diction. The look in your eyes that caresses everything unconsciously, including me. I think I loved you from the beginning.
Annette decided to do everything to seduce our sister's husband.
Me too.
Annette's strategy is simple, relentless, luminous. She offers Jean-Louis the freshness of her 22 years. When she has a man in mind, she does not give up. Jean-Louis is already taken. He's subjected to torture. He struggles, but the outcome is fatal.
My strategy is this. I will be Annette. I will live this love through her because I am worth nothing and she has everything. Youth, beauty, whiteness, she is good enough. I will do everything, I mean everything. Everything to rush her into the arms of beautiful Jean and do nothing, I mean nothing, to open Felicia's eyes. I will keep an eye. I will be on the sidelines because I am non-existent. I will be the stage director. I will push them on stage cleverly without seeming to interfere. Yet, I will be maneuvering.
And that's the end of that.
Largely ignored by scholars, Marie Chauvet's 100 or so page novella, The Vultures or Birds of Prey, written while in exile in New York, sometime between 1968 and 1973, published posthumously in 1989, combines genres, theater, fable, what year? 1986. Thank you.
No, it was important. It was the year the dictatorship
ended. Theater, fable, and Romanesque prose, and in so doing presents the reader with protagonists from varying social categories. Beggars, the urban poor, peasants, the new, it would be assumed, Duvalierist bourgeoisie, and of course, the more long-standing bourgeoisie from which Chauvet herself emerged. The story takes place at the time that the dictator passes away, and it is generally understood that his young son will take over. If Legend of the Flowers was about submission to a male and white order, and the three novellas in Love, Anger, Madness are about what it means to resist oppression, or at least try, this last novella is about the inevitability of certain people suffering. This is also the first place where Chauvet fully embraces depicting protagonists who emerge from social classes that are not her own. Quite subtly, the novella privileges the narrative voice of a child, as well as the non-human voice of a cat, both which in addition to the third-person narrator attempt to depict the various ways in which many different social types, including the perpetrators, experience suffering. The cat literally ties the narrative together, for it is the only being allowed to transit from the wealthy bourgeois family to the Duvalierist bourgeoisie to the poorest families. Edwidge Danticat, writing about Chauvet's work, reflects, "But is all suffering equal?" Marie Chauvet wonders, when the people who suffer are not considered equal. At the heart of Danticat's question is, of course, the notion of human rights, whereby all humans, not just some humans, should be protected from suffering. And lurking in Bel Ticat's interrogation is the fact that Chauvet understood very well that not all groups of humans are considered equally by an international world order.
Birds of Prey by Marie Chauvet, translated from the French by Carolyn Shred. Part 2, The Poor. The poor, see, they hunger for bread, and so they eat the cat. The blind girl wakes up and sits up on the mat. She runs her hand over the younger brother to make sure he's there and turns her head towards a pile of wooden boards. She stares at them with her eyes wide, veiled by a double cataract. She sniffs loudly, feels along the floorboards, and smells her hands. She senses the cat's presence immediately. Fearing it will escape, she leans over the sleeping child and awakens him with a shake. "There's a cat in the house," she whispers. "If you cry, it'll go away. Don't say anything. Don't do anything till Papa gets back. Do you understand?"
"Yes," the child answers. "Do you think it'll go away?"
"No. If you stay still, it'll be here when Papa comes back. Lie down and suck your thumb." The hours pass slowly, too slowly, because of the silence, because of the stillness. The blind girl hears her heart beat, beat, beat. She hears the heartbeat of the child lying next to her. And behind the boards, she hears the heartbeat of the cat. Usually, she sings to make the time pass. She knows lots of songs, the sad and mournful farming songs that cradled her childhood, joyous carnival songs, and many more she learned along the way. One day, when she was singing, a lady cried out, "Good God, where on earth does nature's beauty lie?" Adelia had no idea what she meant, but if she had, she might have taken it as a compliment for her thin, dark face with its small dimples. She knew about people and the ways of the world. Her affliction had worsened gradually. They knew she was blind the day she asked for light, even in the bright sun. She remembered Tulia, her young mother, worn down by pregnancies and her heartbreaking cough. Great Hortensia, who sat on the ground between her legs while she combed through her hair. Papa Timothée, whose hair was so white, it was as if he wore a cloud around his head. She remembered, too, the large hut with its straw roof, a field of coffee trees, food pulled straight from the ground, and grinding coffee. Then misfortune arrived and turned everything upside down. From one day to the next, here her memories blur because that was when she went blind, she found herself on the road carrying her young brother cradled in her arms, unable to see him ever again.
"Papa Bondier? Dear God, Papa!" she murmured. "Please bring Papa home early today."
The asphalt road with its sticky, burning tar melts under Alcindor's bare feet, stretches out endlessly before his eyes like the shimmering white belly of a great snake. He follows it down to the docks, to the busy, bustling world where sailboats arrive from the country, filled with cargoes of fruit and salted fish, to the lines of tradesmen with their mahogany trinkets and other curios spread out along the pavement, waiting to be sold to tourists. Alcindor, too, could have worked this trade, buy for a low price, then resell to Blanc foreigners with a little profit on the side. That was easy enough. But to do it, he needed some money to get started. And where could he find that?
That morning, Alcindor walked many long hours under the sun, hoping to find work. Pursued by misfortune, he found neither a barrow of goods to push nor a boat to unload. As they say, bad luck is an evil beast that latches onto its unhappy victims like a crab. What was he to do? He had to get the broth he had promised his children onto the fire, whatever it took. And if not a broth, then good God, I've been calling you to help me constantly, then at least give us some sweet potato or a crust of bread. Something other than cassava, something different from cane syrup. It's all they've had to eat for months. If he had to steal, he would. If he had to kill, he would kill. One way or another, he would put broth on the fire. As Alcindor was musing over these desperate thoughts, he spied the toad man hopping and sliding over to him on his mat.
"You looking for work, brother?"
"That's right, brother. I need work. Four children, you know."
"Sell your blood, brother."
"Brother, what do you mean?"
Where are you from that you don't know that round here they buy the blood of the poor? However dirty and sick to death we are, they pay us 15 piastres for just one quart of our blood. $3 whole, brother.
Is that really true?
It's the truth. Go over there, give them your arm, and in less than an hour, you'll earn 15 piastres. Go see. Ah, now look how skinny you are, brother. So thin, like me. Maybe you won't pass the exam either. What they want is big, strong, poor people, and that's pretty hard to find.
Are they Lugavu? Are they vampires?
Alcinda wondered mistrustfully.
They're the only ones with a reputation for lacking other people's blood. Wouldn't it be better to find out before going and handing over my arm like an idiot? Brother, why do they buy our blood? He asks the toad man.
To sell it again, they say, to the Americans.
And what do those foreigners do with our blood?
That I don't know, brother. No one can tell me. The poor people sell their blood and get their $3. That's enough for them.
They don't die from it?
No, brother. Only sometimes they get weaker when they sell it too often. Two or three unlucky ones die, like that young man with the stump arm. But his last breath was in the arms of a woman. So, you see. Toadman raises a finger in the air. The only thing that troubles me, he confides, is the bodies disappearing from the morgue. Now that, brother, that's a mystery. If you faint in the street or die there and the ambulance comes, you disappear, brother. Poof, just like that, without a trace. Of course, for most of the wretches, there's no one to claim their body.
Yes, but if that ever happened to me, I've got four children who'd claim my body.
You're lucky, brother, Toadman says.
Full of hope, Alcinda hurries along to the place he's heard about. He finds a wretched crowd there, standing, waiting under the beating sun.
The door of the simple building opens, and a nurse in a white blouse appears. She lets them in one by one. Then doctors press, squeeze, and examine every crevice of their bodies. You might have washed and changed your shirt, the nurse reproaches Alcinda. You stink like a hog. Although he's so skinny, they decide he is strong and healthy enough to be bled. He holds out his arms, thoroughly overwhelmed, and starts when the needle pricks him. Looking at the tube filling up with his blood, he thinks,
I'm doing this for my children. I'm selling my blood for them to give them the broth I promised. My God, these people are good. Paying me $3, three great big American dollars for just a quart of my poor blood.
When the nurse tells him they are going to give him back his blood, he cries out in despair.
Blood, don't they want it?
No, the nurse answers. They want it, but they've kept the part of your blood they needed. They give you back the rest.
Gratis, for free?
The nurse smiles. Yes, gratis.
What a blessing, Alcinda thinks to himself. So this is work I can count on. If they like my blood, I'll come every week, every day even, to give it to them. He collects his $3 triumphantly and heads straight for the market. He buys sweet potato, yam, salted beef, a bunch of watercress, then stops in front of a display of small flowered dresses. Adelia really needs some new clothes, but on further thought, 2 yards of rough Siam cloth would be far more practical, because one day or another, the 11-year-old girl would be a woman, and in trepidation, he had watched his daughter's developing breasts, her growing legs, which 2 old dresses only half covered now. Yes, soon he would have a young lady to care for, to teach and guide. Carrying his supplies, he returned quickly to the shack. He noticed the door was closed and was concerned. The blind girl recognized his footsteps and opened the door to him straight away. She put her head around the door and placed her finger on her lips.
Quiet, Baba, she says, or you'll let the cat out.
Cat?
There's a cat in the house, behind the wooden planks.
Blessed day! Lucky day! And to think, just this morning, he was feeling so hopeless. All it took was a minute for everything to change, for everything to regain its vigor and color.
I felt it, I caught the scent, and as well as the smell of the ratidate. She leans down and sweeps her hand across the floorboards. There, Papa. That's where it ate the rat.
The father looks at the floor and immediately remembers the bloody marks he washed away the day he entered the shack for the first time. So it was only the rat's blood. Blessed be the good Lord. Often at night he had thought about it, you know, imagining he could hear a soul in pain. We'll get that cat, he exclaims. He pulls a knife out of his sack and holds it ferociously with his fist.
Lolo wakes up because he suddenly spoke too loudly. My stomach's empty, Papa, he complains.
You'll eat, the father answers. Silently, he moves towards the planks of wood, and there he sees the cat with his eyes flickering in terror. It's standing up, fur on end, tail straight, staring at the armed fist as it rises. It slips between the boards, rushes through the man's legs, and runs into the hole. Tole! Alcindor exclaims, damn it! It's hiding in a hole. He kneels down, puts his arm in up to his elbow, feels the animal's rough back. The cat scratches him with its claws. He pushes his arm in further, feeling for the neck, and grabs hold of it tight, very tight, tighter and tighter. Then he hears the suffocating rattle of death. His hand shakes with the desperate convulsions of the animal. Then the twitches become more irregular. The body drops heavy, and very slowly, he pulls the cat, with its foaming tongue hanging between its teeth, out of the hole.
At that very moment, Joseph and Tintin knock at the door.
Open it, the father tells Adelia. I've got it.
It's dead, Papa, says the blind girl, walking with her arms outstretched. I don't hear its heartbeats anymore.
We've some good days ahead of us, Alcindor announces to his children. Light the fire, put water on to boil in the pot. As soon as night falls, I'll skin the cat to salt and spice it. Joseph, go dig a hole to bury its skin and remains. There must be no traces of it anywhere. As soon as you put the broth on the fire, dig the hole over there, under the mapu tree. Dig it deep, very deep. Do you understand, petit moi?
Yes, Papa.
The father lays the cat across his knees, cuts off its head, feet, and tails, which he throws into a piece of paper along with the guts and skin. Then he cuts the body into small pieces, washes and salts it.
Looks just like a fine mother hen, Lolo exclaims.
It's true. It doesn't look like a cat at all, says the father. Once they're washed and salted, all meats are the same.
They arrested two men near the market, Joseph recounts as he pours water into the cooking pot.
Why?
They were thieves. The police beat them, and they were crying and begging for mercy.
If they stole, Alcindor states, then they were wrong. Your grandfather, Papa Timotei, never forgave a thief. The broth cooks in no time on the big fire. Alcindor fills the cup, then three small calabash bowls that he hands out to the children.
Replenished, the blind girl sings as she cradles her little brother. After this good meal, with the prospect of eating the cat stewing on the fire tomorrow, she feels her strength return, along with her joy. And when she feels joyous, it comes out in song. The voice coming out of her rises up so high that she has to work to tame it, as it imitates everything. Birdsong, reed flutes, cowbells.
Sing while I dig, Joseph tells her as he picks up the hoe. Sing a conbeat work song. It'll remind me of Laku at Papa Timotei's compound. While digging the hole, Joseph discovered a body. The hoe struck against something hard, which at first he thought was a stone. He dug away until a hand appeared, then an arm. Then he dropped everything and ran for his father.
So it wasn't the rat's blood, Alcindor said straight away. The tortured soul of this man still haunts this house where I am taking refuge with my poor children. Throwing the remains of the cat down next to the body, he buries everything, feverishly piling the earth on the grave. We've seen nothing, found nothing. Do you understand, Joseph? It's a big secret that could cost us our lives. Button your lips. Not a word. Don't talk about it to anyone, not even your sister, not even your brothers. We'll leave this place as soon as possible.
100 cats stolen in less than a month. 100 beautiful, tender, plump cats, all belonging to rich and powerful rulers.
The cat's owners immediately lodged their complaints against those miserable thieves, demanding police security measures for their villas and their pets. Rewards were promised to anyone, civilians or soldiers, whose zeal would help the honest citizens rid them of these immoral criminals. Since when in this country have cats been stolen for food? This could further spoil the image, the irreproachable reputation of the rulers of this sunny isle. It could damage the economic situation, which had improved considerably in the past months. Look at these marvelous mansions, the new buildings, statues erected in memory of the old tyrant, these short and long-term projects, and all the millions elicited from the United States and dropped by handfuls into the streets. This trend in banditry must be curtailed immediately. They must arrest and shoot without mercy all the lazy louts who refuse to work and prefer to wait for night to go about their thievery. Grandiose speeches were broadcast on the radio and put in print, sentencing all cat thieves to death. And the order was given for anyone who was armed to shoot on sight. All the rich villas and little palaces were placed under military guard. Under torture, many unfortunates, guilty or not, admitted to having eaten a cat.
Papa, Joseph said that morning, they're arresting and killing all the cat thieves.
That's nothing to do with us, petit moi, Elsinda answers. We didn't go into a rich person's house to steal it, we didn't. We found a cat here, and it was nothing but a poor cat, all mangy and limping.
Policemen shouted right in front of me, death to all of them. Death to the cat eaters, the vultures.
They're the vultures, Alcinda replies in revolt. They devour the lives of people, and it's them who are the murderers.
First of all, thank you to all the actors and to us for the reading. It is always, I think, something very special to hear the words, you know, of the writer and to have them performed by truly trained artists who know their craft as the university's craft, create their speeches and papers they do create, those monologues. It takes a lifetime to do it. It all looks so easy, but it is quite something unique. And also, as we feel, I think that this room theater is one of the great things to create a community. I feel we already are a group, you know, everybody in the same room here, all heard the same thing. And it is something unique. It only existed tonight, and it already connects us. First, maybe a question to the director. What did you know about Marie Chauvet before, and what did you learn, and what do you think of it?
I had not heard of her name before Ancha contacted me to direct the readings, and that's true for the five actors as well. So we learned about her together. I did a crash course. I read all of your work, especially Kayama's, and that's how I learned about her story, her biography, and her body of work. I'm thrilled. I'm so glad I know her. She's right in my wheelhouse in terms of what I'm interested in. So it was a good fit.
What did you hear? What does it say to you? What is the work? How do you read it, or how does the work read you?
Well, I have to say that, I'm going to answer that around the corner. I thought that Legend of the Flowers would be the hardest one for us to grapple with, and then the second two would be more straightforward, and that was opposite. When we got to rehearsal, the actors apparently really felt with the flowers. They really knew how to do that, and that was the easiest one to rehearse. But the more difficult work was Love and Birds of Prey. I think because I find her work to be, her later work to be very subtle, multi-layered, ambiguous. She creates quite difficult characters to get a handle on. So that's how it speaks to me, is that I think it's like before and after. I mean, the work that she did at age 30, Legend of the Flowers, was, I think someone said it was a minor work. I don't know if it was minor, but it was certainly early, and she wasn't a mature artist yet. And the later work I find quite difficult to grasp. Also, the material that we were given, these plays have no character assignments. So I could see Love as being a solo show, but Birds of Prey seems to me that it would want to have an ensemble, but that adaptation leaves it up to us about how to assign the lines. So that was another layer of complexity.
Could you see those such plays in the city of New York where people come and what do you think? Is it a message from a world that's too far away now? Or is it
No, it feels like it was written this morning. I think Love especially would appeal. She's a fascinating character. Claire is amazing. how she manipulates and how she tries to get what she wants and how she reveals herself unknowingly, I think would be a fascinating role for a virtuoso actress.
Judith, thank you so much for coming. It's always an honor when you take the time from your for sure busy life to come and visit us, and we collaborate with the Haitian Playwright Project after 3 weeks under the earthquake. You have followed theater, especially of course French, original French theater over decades, whether it's in France and Africa, whether it's French Canadian or others. Marie Chauvet, where does she fit in? What do you think of her?
Well, first of all, she doesn't really fit in because she's not a playwright, right, except for The Legend of the Flowers. And I actually came this evening with Olivier Barrault showing up at NYU to do a talkback with a theater guy named Jean-Michel Rive. Olivier Barrault runs a kind of one day, one book kind of program on French television and French radio, and he comes to NYU once a month and he does this talk back. And I said, oh, I'm going to do this thing on Marie Chauvet, and he said, who is that? So that's just an example of the fact that she is not as well known as she should be. Really, because I do think that Amour, Colère, and Folie is a great book. So as far as where the theater is concerned with Marie Chauvet and what I know about her, is I do know about this adaptation, which Stephanie Berard knows, and I'm sure that Thomas knows it, and Christian knows it as well, but I don't know how many people know it. And it's pretty interesting to study because it is written as a monologue. And all three of these novellas are reworked as monologues. And while it makes a lot of sense to have done this with Amour, because it is narrated as a first-person narration by Claire, this is not the case of the second one, Colère. There's a third-person narrator that devolves into something else. But José Pria has decided to have it narrated by the mother, by Laure, which is curious. And the third one, which is really narrated in the story of this drunken, crazed poet, René, he turns around and has it narrated by the rape victim, Cécile. So all three of the in his version of it, all three of the novellas become resistant stories narrated by women, which I think is a pretty interesting gesture on his part. But I think as far as, I was thinking about what you did, Alice. Can I ask Alice a question?
Absolutely.
So I could see why Amour would be really, really hard to do because and as would be all of these three plays at the same time, I think they would be fascinating to work on. Because as you say, it's absolutely virtuoso sort of stuff. But you felt, I guess, that you needed to break up that monologue because you gave it to several of your actors to read.
Well, I have hired 5 actors, so I wanted to use them. It's one thing, practical thing. And second thing, I was really cognizant of making the story clear to the audience, trying to. And so even when they're talking about themselves in the third person, Elsinore goes and does this, I had the actor playing Elsinore say it in hopes that it would filter down to the audience that this is who we're talking about. So that it was practical, actually more than anything else. And also, just it's kind of cruel to give an actress a 9-page monologue with 4 hours of rehearsal. So that was the other reason, the other direction. It wasn't really fair to Clotilde.
But if you had enough time, would you want to tackle it as a monologue?
Yes.
It's not an impossible thing to do, you don't think?
No. No, I don't think so. But it would require, like, you know, the full 4 weeks of rehearsal.
In the version that I saw, it's the only one I saw of the three, but they were all performed. The director did not trust his actor to be able to handle this, his woman actor. And so he put a dancer on stage to represent Jean Rousse, the object of desire. So we had this kind of strange situation in which there was a woman narrating and telling her story, right, with this guy, I hate to say this, but flitting around the stage, kind of wondering what the hell he was doing, because he never really understood.
When did you see the performance?
I saw this performance at, there's a theater space in Paris called the Tarmac, which is set aside for Francophone theater productions, which is both a good thing and not a good thing, because it kind of ghettoizes them, since they don't get play in other theaters there, but that's where I saw this.
Yeah. If I heard why you said you're teaching Jenny at the moment, and you see some lines within that tradition of modernity and intemporalities, is that something you compare to?
I guess I was teaching Genet and Artaud today, which is interesting to when you start thinking about Marie Chauvet. They're not similar, really, except where they might all come together is they take you someplace that's very, that shakes you up. Mm-hmm. They're especially Claire, but the women are not easy to figure out. And they do live in this place where they hate themselves and they love themselves. They like themselves. I thought that was very interesting in the reading. It was very clear. So you can't figure these characters out very easily. And of course, in Genet's The Blacks, you have 6 different layers of reality. So you never really get to the bottom of who's who, right? You never even know what their real names are. You just know that they're playing. Here, I don't think you have that kind of confusion in terms of who people, just the people themselves are very complex. And they're much more psychologically dense, whereas Genet's characters are ciphers, but they're not psychologically dense.
Mm-hmm. But certainly they are, as you both said, very, very strong characters, strong female characters, and then play with light and shadow, with strong emotions and very weak ones, and hiding and showing certainly makes for a voice of the 20th century of a woman writer we all connect to, especially also looking at her extraordinary life. You also read some pieces today. What is your personal connection to Marie Chauvet?
Well, I don't have one, really. I think I come to Haitian literature and Chauvet in particular from a social science background. I am an anthropologist by training, a feminist anthropologist, and I've done a lot of work and performance on my own. But my interest in that work has always been really because she was such a rebel. And sort of like that sense of knowing about her, learning about her at school.
A rebel? Tell us a bit more.
A rebel as in the fact that she basically just went against social strictures and wrote, as we heard earlier. And, you know, I mean, the thing that's interesting that I can add to this is I have this sort of aversion to Haitian literature in a sense because I didn't come to it through it as part of my upbringing. It was something that I discovered here. I migrated at 11 and so forth, and I didn't come from a literary family, right? So this sense, my entry into the arts was not at all Haitian. So I've made a return to it. And through that return, you know, the ability to sort of recognize a complexity that I now am writing against. Well, I'm trying to expose more of, I should say, because I actually had learned it. I often talk about the language of how Creole and French for me were my languages of submission, right? This is where you learn how to be proper. I went to Catholic school, how to be a good girl, like that good Haitian girl. She was not a good Haitian girl. And that's because she wrote. But not just because she wrote, because of what she wrote, and when she wrote, and how she wrote, right? I mean, I think, you know, when you look at the characters, part of what you have a sense of, that complexity is not something we're automatically given. It is something you actually have to fight for. It is something that has to be decoded. And it's not just within the context of Haitian literature itself, but blackness in the context of white imagination. So for me, you know, coming at this situated in the diaspora as what I call a Haitian American, and I, you know, really do call myself that, and then being able to come at it with those lenses, and I'm also a performer, I'd like to think I was a rebel in the womb, so that helps.
So you, how meaning is you could have mirror yourself?
No, not necessarily. I mean, I think the thing is, it's less mirroring than, I think, you know, when you think of certain ideas that, you know, sort of the tragic milagre and so forth, they need to be more complicated. This is part of what I was trying to say earlier, because too often, if you're Haitian, well, first of all, to have someone write about the complexity of Haitian identities is already revolutionary, right? I mean, that is a really important thing to actually have documented, because the tendency is to think of Haitians in very simple terms. There are people to this day who does not recognize that Haiti has a range of somatic differences amongst people. They will look at someone and say, oh, you're not Haitian, you couldn't possibly be Haitian, because the image of Haiti and Haitians is always all black, whatever that is. And even within blackness, there's a range that's completely ignored. So part of it for me, as a black Haitian woman, really is to think through how complex that is. Knowing within my family, for example, there is a range of colors and a range of classes. We were never reducible to that singularity that we've been given. Yet that's the only way that people saw us. So part of what I'm interested in is anything that complicates it. And for me, she does that well. She does that well. And she does it in such a way that it's hard to sort of incarcerate her. And that the ability that she has to be slippery is necessary for us to get a shred of that humanity that keeps eluding us.
Thank you to Kaima and Alessandra. You both are scholars, and it's a big universe what to write about, what to focus on, also in your career. Why did you choose her? What is the reason that you think she's such significant to put on, you know, great involved through the evening? What is your evaluation and your meaning you see?
I started writing about Chauvet as part of a constellation of women writers that I was, no, that's not true, a constellation of writers of women that I was looking at from the Caribbean, both French-speaking and Anglophone, and I've been particularly interested in what I started off by calling the ethics of narcissism, but because narcissism is a term that, you know, immediately makes you think of pathology, I've been thinking of it more in terms of the ethics of feminine self-care. Though self-care feels a little too, you know, new way of touching feelings. So I haven't found the right word yet. Somewhere on the range between narcissism and self-care, but the point was I'm interested in women who say no to coercive community, even when that coercive community looks like the right one. Meaning people who stand maybe uncomfortably outside of what we see as feminism, or who stand out uncomfortably outside of racial alliances, but who are in a position where their identities can't be so neatly contained, and how that looks suspicious to the outside world. And I think Chauvet is someone who, yes, I'm a literary scholar, so I try to stay somewhat suspicious of biographical interpretations of text, but I think in her work itself, the women characters she writes, we talked about a little bit this afternoon, they are difficult and disorderly and not always good people. But what they seem to me to have in common is a desire to protect themselves, their individual wanting to survive being in ways that I think women don't often get allowed to portray themselves and still be considered human or good.
I came to the project thanks to Kayana, who invited me to work with her. So I actually wasn't particularly interested in Chauvet for the reason that when I had read Amour Colère for the, when I was at Madison, so about 20 years ago, I found that it was insupportable. It was so, it still is so upsetting to me. And for me to reread something like that, I think it depends on one's personal experience or how deep you get into the text to be able to have distance from it from the first time you read it. And so the only work I've actually ever worked on intimately is the last one, the Birds of Prey translated by Carolyn. And I can handle that because it deals with more of a globalized space. And also I've become recently very interested in Jewishness in the Caribbean, and I was thankful to Thomas Speer for asserting that it was her mother was Jewish. And I think she wrote the Raptors at the same time that Hannah Arendt was writing for the New Yorker and speaking about what evil is and who's capable of it. And it's a very everyday thing. And so to me, I find so much affinities between Chauvet and Arendt, and not because she went and read her and she decided she was going to do something similar. They were doing different things in different places, and that's the work of Régine Joseph. So I am not at all a specialist. I feel a bit strange being up here. I'm just a hard worker who loves to work with Kayama. But I love this play, and I really couldn't handle Chauvet's. It's just too hard on me to read the other stuff. And I think you saw the difference between the first play and the other.
Julius, a question. When do you think, is there something like a terra firma, is that like Haitian literature you observe, you put in context, in the kind of a landscape? Is there something about it, or is that?
Well, I won't claim any expertise in Haitian literature, but let me tell you why José Clio picked this novel. He had just taken over he's from Benin, so he's a West African, but trained for theater in France. And yep. He had just taken over the National Theater in Guadeloupe, and he was looking for a novel to adapt that he felt would be the novel from the Caribbean. And he read a lot of novels from Guadeloupe and Martinique, and none of them spoke to him. But his Haitian friend said, you must read Marie Chauvet, and he did. And he said, this is it, this is what I want to do. I think, but I wish someone else would speak to this who's more of an expert, so it probably should be Kayo who does this. It's to my mind, from what I've read of Haitian literature, it actually stands apart. And she stands apart, although there are other women writers who write about torture and rape in other novels that I've read by Haitian women, like Emily Mox, for example. But still, there's something about the way it sticks with you. This morning when I was rereading again, and I kept thinking about Dora, this character who has been raped, but the word is never used, nor is there a lot of narrative about. We just see her walk down the street with her legs apart. In great pain. That's what we see. I read this novel the first time maybe 7 years ago. I have never forgotten that image. So it's the way those kinds of things stick with you, I think. And she's just fantastic about setting up these images and making them stick.
I agree. I think that something extraordinary that she's able to do that facilitates them making it stick is, and perhaps what Pia saw in this novel that was at once the novel of the Caribbean for him, despite or perhaps even because of its singularity, is the interplay between the local and the global that she embeds in the heart of every one of her works. And it is extraordinary the extent to which many of her, many, most, all of her works have this claustrophobia to them. They are, aside from, yes, no, rigorously sort of contained in a Haitian universe, but she reaches a universal that goes, that's unmediated to my mind by the national or by the communal, but is the individual in the world in their complexity, their inconsistency, their degradation, their pathologies, their narcissism, and their generosity, certainly. But she is so unsparing in her evaluation of the human condition that she doesn't do the dumb thing of having these kind of good characters, these bad characters, people you're meant to feel sorry for and people you're meant to vilify. The humanity that is in each and every one of the characters and that comes in things about them that even seem contradictory mean that we have to be thinking about who they are. We have to, they resonate inside us, they confuse us and make us uncomfortable, but in those ways that that make them stick with us, I think, that make them relatable. I hope it doesn't sound banal, but I do think it's extraordinary. And, you know, Régine is very good about keeping us contextualized. You know, Amour, colère et folie, 1968, that's like an explosive year, right? And as Alessandra said, it's not that she was picking from the outside and putting, oh, I'm gonna do this version of this in Haiti. She was on the pulse of this. She was having these thoughts and these feelings from within the cloistered world of the Haitian bourgeoisie in the 1960s, and yet able to speak well beyond that world in ways that, that resonated so deeply with what was going on more broadly. And I'd say that that's the case if you line up her works with their historical moment. They match not only Haitian history, but world history. And her capacity to do that, I think, is what makes her so extraordinary to so many of us.
I think that the other thing, that's why the Légende des Fleurs is also kind of interesting, but the, thinking about Haitian writers, the other Haitian writer who does this is Edwige Danticat. But, and I think she holds on to that complexity, and I think she gives us a feeling of the horror of the Duvalier regime. So it's something about also in the context of other Caribbean novelists, whereas everyone in the Caribbean claims Toussaint Louverture and the Haitian Revolution, only the Haitians get to have Duvalier. The other Caribbean novelists, I think, I think the other Caribbean novelists don't want to touch that. It's too terrible. And so there's something about that terribleness of that particular historical moment that's really very strong. And
that
do you think that's right?
Yeah, she's kinder. She is gentler, I think, with the world.
Gentler.
Restrained rage.
Yes.
She's very restrained. She really manages it well. I think, you know, I wanted to say after you were done that, you know, another thing, I mean, might sound simplistic, but it's really important to also keep her in mind in terms of that feminist tradition, Black feminist tradition of longing to tell, that need to tell, no matter how horrifying that story must be told. The significance of the telling is something that I think, again, you know, in terms of how we think about Haiti, right, we already know Haitian narratives or narratives of Haiti. So then, in a sense, she's an intervention of a particular kind precisely because she's giving voice to the most horrific aspects of lives of women. And it's not something that proper girls do. I think coming back to that notion of propriety is really key because it was also about the class aspect of being silenced, right? It would have been perfectly fine for someone who's from the gutter to just blah, 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 blah. But to be sort of like from the bourgeoisie and be restrained and you're supposed to uphold certain social dictum and she decided to eschew them. I think so it's really important then to sort of look at the tension between that and the desire to tell and not just tell, to go raw. I mean, I was just like, no, I am not reading this because I was like, I read it once and that was enough for me. That was, I'm with you. I was just like, we're good. No, I'm not doing that scene. That's not the one I want to read. And part of it, I was just like, I'm in my happy space. So it's really, I think it's, you know, there's something to be said in terms of thinking about Haitian feminist agency. And you know, I grew up with a mother who always said, "Pas le choix." And I go, you know, like, what do you mean you don't have a choice? But there is that sense generationally, right, that things happen to you. And part of the burden in living with what happened, whatever it is, that I tend to find amongst people who sort of grew up around under the dictatorship is you didn't have a choice and you don't have to tell. And so you die, it implodes, it stays in there. So what it means to then revolt and tell it in its worst possible form with the degout, is something to think through in the integrity of that. There's integrity in that, Sine, which appeals.
There's incredible guts when you think that in, was it 1961, that Jacques-Stéphane Alexis was killed by the Duvalier regime, so writers were being killed. Now I'm thinking about all the things I've learned in reading Régine Joseph. I don't know that Marie Chauvet has any antecedents, any feminine antecedents, right? That I don't know very much about at all, because all of the great Haitian novelists up to Marie Chauvet, in my understanding of it, have all been men.
Not necessarily the great, but the recognized.
The recognized.
Yes. Yes. So there may be a whole lot of other novelists that we and writers that we don't know of. Yes, of course.
So yeah, let's move to audience questions, and we start.
Regine has a question.
So it's interesting because it's just I've been thinking about this a lot, and so is there a way? So you know, everybody knows I drink the Marie Chauvet Kool-Aid. I love Marie Chauvet. She's amazing. You know, I've been writing about her since I was in college. But I'm listening to you all talk, and I just had this thought. So is there a way, especially when I think about Chantal and I were kind of looking at each other because we have this friend, one of our very good friends, Nadia Minow, one of the things that drives her the most crazy in life is when people say Marie Chauvet was the first Haitian woman writer, right? When obviously, you know, there were others before her. And so is there a way, though, that this, we have to continue, I'm happy that this spotlight is being shined on Chauvet, but is there a way that we're creating a Chauvet exceptionalism, right? So I would love for some people to talk about the dangers of that. And how do we avoid that? You know, how do we avoid that as scholars and thinkers?
We don't. I think about this a lot. When I talk to people, notably to Nadev, and to her uncle, Lionel, and he was really mean to me. He's like, why are you writing about Chauvet? Don't you know about Nanny Malvar? I said, yes. He's like, don't you know about Nanny Pals? I said, yes. And I had this kind of argument with him. I lost, but what I was saying, I still believe. I was just kind of like, you know, not courageous enough to keep fighting. Is that let us let her open space, you know? And there doesn't need to be a Chauvet or. It should be a Chauvet and. And if people are paying attention to Chauvet, great, fantastic. And let us also then kind of push back against that she is the first and say out loud the names of the authors and the writers and the artists that made the space for her. Right. So it's up to us not to back away from Chauvet out of some fear that we're exceptionalizing her, but rather, again, let her make more space around her. So that she's not as so that everyone knows she's not the only one. Right?
But she is
Thomas, can you take the mic?
Yes, but not the only
but,
one.
No, I mean you have Cléante Varsin, you have Suzanne Comey, and there are other women, but I mean I think especially Gina, I appreciate what you're saying of you know, these horrors of Alexander as well. But there is, you know, and I think no one understands this in English. When you have that level, she has a level of language. Mm-hmm. She has a way of working that formal French, the most uptight, and then she'll throw in these vulgarisms and creolisms, and I'm sorry, there is an exceptionalism with her. I mean, yes, there are other exceptionally talented writers from Haiti and from elsewhere, but I know the censorship added to that too, because there was a mystique, because people wanted to find her books and you couldn't. But I'm sorry. I mean, I argue with Lionel as well. You know.
Did you win?
But she no. Well, I mean, yes, in a sense that I don't agree with him. And there is certain jealousy when the trilogy came out. you know, it had lots of press, and the only person who said something negative was the owner. But maybe that's, you know, that's just him, and those are those things. But I think that when you look at language, I mean, people can look at the language of Jacques Roumain and know that, you know, there is something exceptional in what he was doing as well, as far as working French with a Creole, you know. But Marie Chauvet, yes, we're dealing with the horrors. We were looking at a lot of this today. But there is a level of her language, I'm sorry. And I'm sorry for the French people who don't know her, and I don't care. You know, we have been teaching her in the United States for a long time, and we will continue to do so. And we don't care what the French people read, but it is a level of language. No, I mean, and others can say this, the reader in the original, that there is an exceptionalism, I'm sorry.
But I think she can still be exceptional. We don't have to. To me, exceptionalism is a whole other set of discourse, right, as opposed to. So we can still say that she's exceptional without being kind of trapped in that. But
and talk about minor works of hers as well. That wasn't all great.
I wanted to, first of all, thank you for the stagings, the readings.
Yes.
They were extraordinary. And and also the team of performers as well, as much credit. They did an extraordinary job of bringing these texts to life. We talked about this earlier, about not most of us never having been able to see any of these works performed, either in their entirety or in the condensed, the abridged versions that you chose. So I wanted to ask first a question of you, and then a question of the panelists. The question for you is about what you chose to stage, what other texts you chose, and why you chose it. And then I'm curious, this would be for those of you who do know Chauvet's work, either on the panel or in the room, if seeing Chauvet performed changed your way of thinking about Chauvet being read, for you, those of you who've read her. So,
The section from Legend of Flowers, I just chose the beginning because it seemed the further we got into that play, the harder it was going to be to understand. And also there are many more flowers and
yes.
things and nature of things that come into play. So I thought, okay, let's keep it simple. But the other two, it was easier to dip in the middle, and actually those excerpts were threaded together. It wasn't even a continuous passage for either of those pieces. And so for Love, I wanted to hear about Claire's manipulation of Annette. And actually I had wanted to do another 5 pages, but we would have been here until 10 o'clock. So we got the beginning of that manipulation. And then for Birds of Prey, the eating of the cat, the capturing of the cat and the cooking of the cat just seemed like the most visceral, exciting part of the play. I have to say when we read it as a company, cold, I think the poem at the beginning tells you what's going to happen.
Yeah.
The poor eat the cat. That went over the actors' heads. They were, you know, just trying to like figure out what was happening. And when we got 5 pages in and they said, wait a minute, they're gonna cook it? And I was like, uh-huh. So, and I thought, oh, it'd be great if the audience had that experience as well. That it just, you know, it's such a horrible thing. If I can add one thing, I was reading about Brecht today, something completely different. And he talks about, epic theater is when the audience laughs while the characters cry, and vice versa, and when the actors are so thrilled to eat this cat. I really felt this like doom settle over the audience of like, oh no, don't do that. That, you know, what are the circumstances that caused that to happen? I mean, it really felt quite epic in that moment.
Question to the panel about
listening.
Listening. Yeah, yeah. No, listening and reading. And, did it have impact?
You know the answer.
Sure. Oh,
come on.
You know, yeah, radically 1,000% different than sitting in my bedroom or my office, you know, 1,000 books. I'm like, oh, okay, what does this mean? I'm right about that. You know, obviously, it's amazing. I all of the books I read, I should see performed somehow.
Yeah.
You should stage them, please, because I'll be a better scholar. I say that about translation too. But if you can engage with the text in a different way, you get out of what you already brought to it, you know? Like when we read, especially when you're like us, right? Always reading books and how are you gonna teach this? How are you gonna write about this? How are you gonna sound smart? And then you see that they have embodied it and given it back to us, and in so doing, expose the fissures and the cracks and the juiciest bits that somehow in your hundreds of readings and teachings of that same text you missed, it's just mind-blowing. And so again, I hope you will stage everything from Haitian literature so that I can write better.
Okay.
We're at the same university, so this could begin to happen. Yeah.
So I think that what happened to me, and I bet it happened to other people in the audience who know La Légende des Fleurs, who know a little bit about it, that I had read bits of it and thought, flowers, sutar, it was great. It was so funny. It was such a good farce. It was such a good satire. I thought, who the hell does that son think he is? Kind of thing. It was just, and then with the three flowers, and then having Amul right after that, I thought, wow, like you can almost see a prefiguration of Amul in it, can't you, with the attitude towards the men, with this, the three sisters. Yeah, that was really very revelatory for me.
Yeah, I also felt they all talked to each other and gave an overview, but also listening towards the group by saying, you know, as a community and an audience, you know, it's just something that's very special and creates a listening that's very different. Even if you would read alone to one audience member, it would not be the same as we hear. But maybe one or two more questions. Yeah, one.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Good afternoon. I'm a sociologist and I would prefer to speak in French, but I will try to say what I have to say in English. So I'm a sociologist, and time is very important. Time is very important for understand politics, for understand economy, for understand culture, and so forth. So when Marie Chauvet wrote, she published like in the 60s, and the 60s was a very important time in social science. Corresponds to a paradigmatical change in the social science. At that time, I would like to know all the time and to what extent the fact she published like in the 60s, what kind of reading, what kind of book she read in the 60s, and or she received also external influence to what happened in social science, you know, in a global, yes.
Do we know what influences
were? I would assume that because she was corresponding with Simone de Beauvoir, which that she was certainly reading what was going on in France at the time. She was quite well connected to the French intellectual establishment.
So she was publishing in the 50s.
She was publishing
so
she was publishing in the 50s, and when the play was put together in the late 40s. So her career really spans about 20 years, if we count 1968 as the last publication of her lifetime. This is a very big question. In the introduction, I read an excerpt of a letter that Marie Chauvet had written, when she says that my education is, I am responsible for my own education because I read a lot. And I think the photo that was on the board that Kayam and Alessandra Bruni picked as to put on the cover of the French Studies is Marie Chauvet in her bedroom with her bookcase behind her. So we can zoom in and see, to answer your question precisely, for a sociologue. but I think just from that point of departure itself, we can see very widely that this is someone who is very well read and pretty much an autodidact. One of her characters, Lotus, says in Fidaïti, l'éducation que reçoit la femme la prépare toute la vie à se douter d'elle-même. And what Lotus, the character in that novel, her, the narcissist, undertakes is to do an education, and she reads a lot, and she starts quoting Nietzsche, she starts quoting Schopenhauer, she quotes Victor Hugo, she quotes passages from the Bible, and so if we take that just already in 1954, this is someone who can engage intellectually with a range of texts, and I'm only saying these because the name dropping them sounds more impressive, but we can read Marie Chauvet. There's your usual to Marie Chauvet intertextually with several thinkers and other literary traditions. And Simone de Beauvoir was also one.
Maybe we're close to 2 hours, which is for us at the Segal Center, at least it's a long time. Maybe for Chabot, devotees of the unusual. But I would like to thank you all for coming. Yes.
I want to say a few words of thanks also. This will not be too long, but we'd be remiss if we didn't. Alessandra's going to be coming around for those of you who participated. I'll try to be brief. I've talked a lot today and learned an enormous amount. First, from the very elegant stage setting work done this afternoon by Vision. I'm looking at you. I'm looking at you, Vision. You're talking to other people. I'm looking at you. And by Thomas here this afternoon as well. And then to the insightful presentations done this afternoon also by Stéphanie Bérard, by Christian Flaw, by Régis Jean-Charles, and by Jeremy Glick. We have flowers since the Légion des Fleurs, right? We thought, let's stay on theme here.
They're going to start talking to me later.
It makes it hard. So really, this day has been so enlightening, and it's thanks to the work and thanks to what you've given us to continue thinking through it with Marie Chauvet. And then also the performance and the discussion this evening have brought Chauvet's work to light and brought her into this space, into our here and now today in the most viscerally compelling ways. And so we're very, very grateful to you, Alice Regan, to the actors and to the translators, to Gina Ulisse and to Judy Miller for their commitment to and their engagement with Chauvet's theaters. And we're especially grateful to the Henri Père French Institute, to the Institute for Research on the African Diaspora in the Americas and the Caribbean. No one's here representing, they don't get their flowers. All of their support was crucial to making this happen. And last but by no means least, we certainly could not have pulled this birthday party off without the dedication, the commitment, the organization, the dedication, the goodwill, the generosity, the rigor, and the immense elegance of Frank Henscher here at the Segal Theater. Frank and his team, and by his team, I mean Anja Ogle, and I mean Rebecca Sheehan, and his incomparable superwoman, Yu Chen, who I hope is still here, Yu Chen Liu. Did she get her chance? Okay, those flowers are for you too, so don't let her go home with all of them. They really made this event not just possible, but they made it a pleasure for Alessandra and me to be a part of. So thank you, Frank, thank you, Yu Chen, and happy birthday, Marie Chauvet.
Happy birthday.